So earlier today, we talked about healthcare. And we talked about the challenges that we face in trying to restructure the healthcare system. Now we also have the challenges that we've been working through over the last couple of years on how do we restructure the regulatory system to make it more effective so we can get it to patients faster. So that's what we're going to be talking about in this panel. So first of all, I have with me today two regulatory experts that know a lot more about this than I do. So we're going to let them start off just by giving you a little bit of perspective on what they've been working on, some of the insights that they have, and how they got to this place. Okay, and why don't we start with you, Joni?
Okay. Hi, thank you. Thanks for having me. And so, yeah, a lot's changed over the last couple of years in medical devices and our interactions with the FDA and different regulatory bodies. I would say what's changed the most recently is just the complexity of the devices. As all of you guys have heard, all devices are becoming more complex, and that in turn forces manufacturers to have more in-depth relationships with the agency, making sure that we're going and talking to them early and often. We do this in a couple of ways. We would go on a periodic basis to Silver Springs, where FDA is, and have those relationships, let them know what's coming up, coming down the pipeline for our company. And then also, if there is a unique situation, a unique device that's coming up, we make sure that we have those pre-submission meetings with the agency, get feedback from them on what should our clinical protocol look like, what animal testing should we be doing, what animal models appropriate for the device that that we're testing. And so all of those interactions are so important for us, because the more we engage FDA up front, the more likely they are to pick up the phone and call us and ask us those questions versus stopping the review clock and slowing down the time to market.
Great. Now, you're working with one of the leading cardiovascular medical device companies in the world.
Yes,
okay.
Yes.
And we're trying to really not name names a whole lot here, because we want to make sure that we can have a good, frank discussion. And as we said before with some of the other panels, the opinions of our panelists are not necessarily the opinions of their companies. Just to be safe.
Yes, I would agree. I think that every company has a different perspective in their approach and interacting with the agency. Yeah. Yes.
So on the other side of it, Michelle, you've been doing a lot of work across the spectrum with smaller companies too.
Yes. Yes. So my business specializes in helping innovators and startup companies with ideas get their medical devices to market. And like Joni said, early engagement with the FDA is critical in that path, but most small companies are afraid to engage with the FDA. And they're not aware of these trends of FDA is moving towards more of a partner than a police. They are willing to have conversations. And even with small companies, they have entire organizations within the FDA, one of them called DICE, Device Industry, education program, to partner with the industry, specifically the small medical device manufacturers, to help them understand the requirements that are applicable to device, the systems that they have to in place to develop those devices. So there are a lot of partnership programs and efforts that the FDA is making with industry right now that a lot of small companies aren't taking advantage of those relationships.
And I think that, it's really important as we look at, so often you read in the papers, and it makes it sound like the industry and the FDA are at loggerheads, that we, it's us versus them. And that couldn't be more inaccurate today. There may have been a time, but, we really are, on a journey together to try and figure out how to make this better. So, you talked a little bit about some of your experiences, Joni, but thinking back on, the work you've done with the FDA, if there were two or three tips that you could give to the audience to say, if you do these things, you're going to be a lot more successful than if you don't.
Yes. Getting to know your branch chief, for sure. Second would be, I think, educating FDA. So a lot of times, the reviewers that we're working with might be straight out of school. They don't have the clinical background. They don't have the medical device industry experience. So the more that we can help educate FDA, I think the better off that we are. And so I think that translates into going to FDA, making the effort, taking that day, bringing educators with you, bringing physicians with you. The more that we can educate them on the disease state, the clinical application, it's going to make that review process that much smoother, because they're going to understand what anatomy we're treating, and they're going to be focusing on the right things versus going down a path that might not be the most relevant.
Michelle?
Yes, I've actually had similar experiences to Joni, in that 1 year I put in a 510K submission and got a reviewer right out of school. So I was doing that educational process with the reviewer, not only teaching the reviewer about the device and the technology, but teaching the reviewer about how 510K submissions worked. And then, to my surprise, the next year I did another 510K for the same type of technology, and that reviewer was now a senior reviewer overseeing the new reviewer right out of college. So you really can't underestimate the power of having somebody on your team that not only understands your device and your technology, but understands the way the FDA is supposed to work and can help remind the FDA what their role in this process is, what the regulations, in this particular case, there was also a brand new guidance document out. Industry was trying to figure out what it meant or what it looked like to meet that for FDA. FDA was trying to figure out what their role in reviewing this new standard was, and it involved a lot of communication and education on everybody's parts. And then to that standard, you have to know when standards change as you're in design and development, and do what you can to be compliant with those, as far as not being belligerent, not being, hey, it's a draft guidance. You really have to be open to what the FDA is saying is their state-of-the-art thinking about different technologies, and incorporate them to the extent that you can in the point you are in your design and development.
So anything you want to add to that, Joni?
No, I would definitely agree with everything that you said and that approach too. I think, you know, one thing I would add is FDA doesn't always have the money and the resources to do this on their own, and medical device companies, the larger medical device companies, usually have the money to do that. And so taking the time and investing in educating them is great, yeah.
Okay. So, you know, I can remember in 2011 when I first joined AZBio, and we were in the middle of the UFA discussions. And I had to go to a couple of my board members, and I'm like, what is an UFA? Well, for those of you that don't know, those are user fee agreements. And the user fee agreements we've been negotiating now user fee agreements for the last year and a half, getting ready to get them approved, hopefully momentarily. What have you seen, you know, over the last couple of years? Have those user fee agreements and the payments that the industry makes to the FDA, are we seeing, in your experience, you know, better response times and faster approvals?
I would say that what we've seen recently is greater consistency and more predictability about review times, and I think FDA is being held to the review times that they've published, and we've seen that directly. I think that when you look at the average review times for 510Ks, for PMAs, for de novo submissions, that they're pretty right on track. And so I think that the recent MDUFA fees have increased the predictability of just the review times in general.
So, Michelle, for the smaller companies, I didn't know what an UFA was. Do they know what UFAs are?
No. Most of my clients are just figuring out that there is a quality system of regulation and that there are fees in the first place, much less the fact that they get renewed every 5 years and the impact that that can have on their review times. The renewal is really a double-edged sword because, you know, this year the Congress is asking for, or in the budget, The increase in FDA fees is anticipated to generate $1 billion in revenue for the FDA. And that could mean a significant hike in user fees, which could make a big impact to the budget of a small startup company. However, those user fees are supposed to continue to increase in expedite review times by getting the right staff with the right expertise in place to help review those submissions that have got unique technology. So if we don't pay the user fees, we might not get the right staff or the right competency of staff we need to navigate the submission process efficiently.
Well, and I think, you know, looking back historically, before we had the user fee agreements, and we started with drugs first, we've seen tremendous response on the drug side. Now, with medical devices, it's been a little slower. We didn't get to our first MDUFA until 6 years ago. Mm-hmm. But, before that, technology and data was getting bigger and bigger. The FDA was having fewer and fewer reviewers to address more and more of the resources. So once industry started partnering with the FDA, the same way that industry pays fees and partners with the Patent and Trademark Office, mm-hmm. so it's not just unique to FDA, we really started to see those times come down. But at the same time, we are holding them accountable. And Janet Woodcock was just in front of both the Senate Health Committee and the Energy and Commerce Committee, just last week during all the healthcare stuff. Everybody was talking about the American Healthcare Act. Nobody was talking about that all the FDA, committee hearings were being held at the same time. And, it's critically important when you talk to your congressional people. They, by the way, are all going to be home for 2 weeks in April because of the Passover holiday and the Easter holidays. So they'll be around. But it's really critical. If we don't reestablish the user fee agreements, FDA is going to have to furlough a lot of people, and approvals and things will pretty much grind to a halt. So it's really important, as we continue to work through those. On the other side, we've got 21st century cures, mm-hmm. which was also supposed to help us move things forward. And the budget, same budget discussion that said we're going to raise user fees, said they were going to cut the FDA funding and the NIH funding. So how are we going to get that balance between cures and patient expectations?
Yeah, we're watching all of those things very closely because they have a direct impact to our business for sure. And not only review times, but paying attention to how the money's being spent internally too. And so how are they taking that money and translating that into training their reviewers, making sure they have once-over reviewers, making sure the branch chiefs are more involved in the day-to-day. But I think, what we're seeing though in present day, I'm not sure what future state is going to look like, but present day is the clinical trial requirements are changing, right? And that's been the biggest impact for us. And I think, FDA has been more receptive to looking at things a little bit more creatively. Let's use real world data. Let's use OUS data, which hasn't always been acceptable in the past. And so I would encourage manufacturers to have those discussions with FDA. And, for one example, we're continuing to do a post-market study for a device that was launched, 7 years ago when there's all these new therapies out on the market. And so FDA's receptive to saying, does this still make sense? Like, let's think this through. Let's understand what endpoints are important. And I think that translates too into the patient needs and putting patients first, which is a big part of the Cures Act too, of what should we be considering? Let's not just ask physicians about what the end goals of this product should be. Let's understand what patients care about too. Let's go to that next level of asking them what, because they might be willing to take a higher risk than maybe FDA is historically, right? And so making sure that we're going to that next level and asking patients about what are their concerns, what are their quality of life concerns, so that we can make sure that we translate in those into our regulatory submissions and pass that learning on to FDA too. So so they can help balance that risk benefit discussion.
Yeah. And I think it's, you know, it's really important. I had an opportunity at the patient day.
Okay.
And and see all of the different products. And so many of those products were actually patient designed, you know, where the patient said, you know, I need a better port for my cancer drug, or I need, you know, and it was things that, well, what we had before, we, you know, was quote unquote good enough until the patients told us, oh, not really, right?
Yes.
And I think that a lot of times that's where that innovation comes from. If I'm at a big company, you know, I have a lot of resources where I can go out and I can see that. Michelle, with our smaller companies, how do they get to take advantage of some of those same types of resources?
Well, that's definitely a challenge. Smaller companies often lack the breadth of connections and obviously the depth of pocketbooks. But patients love talking and sharing their experience. And many people that are struggling will talk to anybody and who will listen. Patient advocacy groups will put together patient preference, better, worse surveys, all types of data that you can use. People, you just have to be creative about the groups you start reaching out to. You have to be member of advocacy groups like AZBio that are watching these things and have got these connections and can help help you navigate those paths. But the FDA has approved two medical devices recently that had had it not been for patient advocacy groups particularly voicing their opinion with the FDA about what they were willing to accept in terms of risk, wouldn't have gotten to market. And similarly, on the drug side, there was a drug for Duchenne's muscular dystrophy that was released in the last year or two that the FDA actually commissioned the patient advocacy group to write a guidance document on their perception of benefit and risk that the FDA could use in the approval of drugs. So just be really creative. Don't be in a small companies can tend to be in an engineering or technology bubble. Make sure that you're always doing a true user needs validation and going back to your market. Not only getting your market input from yes, this is or what we wanted, or no, this is not what we wanted, but is this better or worse than our current technologies?
You want to add to that, Joni?
I don't think so. Thank you.
See, they're giving me such complete answers. It's kind of hard. So I think the other thing is we talk about, you know, FDA and as we're going forward, a lot of people think that, you know, you get your FDA approval and then you're done.
You just started.
So as companies, whether they're big companies or small companies, are designing products for, you know, hopefully manufacture for many years to come. What are some of the things that they really have to consider, not just to get the initial approval, but to keep that drug approved?
Well, in the terms of devices, so once you get your 510K, that's, of course, just the start of your commercialization process. But that's also the start of your full-scale quality management system. And what a lot of small companies don't realize is that even when they use subcontractors and contract manufacturers and contract sterilizers and even fulfillment centers where they may not even ever touch their product in manufacturing, that they still have roles and responsibilities within the quality system regulation that occur on an annual basis, like management reviews and internal audits, that occur on an event-related basis, like maybe a supplier quality problem or a customer complaint, and that all those things are real and living systems that require maintenance, they require administration, they require specialized resources in your company, where you might could have gotten by without somebody without quality system in expertise in maybe your design and development. Not a good idea, but I've seen lots of companies do it. You really can't sustain a company post commercialization without that kind of expertise.
Yeah, and I think post-market too, I mean, clinical studies are changing. I touched on that before, but with the release and the in the medical device regulations becoming final in Europe too. It's not going to be so much that we're going to Europe and conducting clinical studies because it's easier to get to market. I mean, it's going to continue the need for clinical studies, the need to answer questions that physicians and patients have are that much more important, and we need to incorporate those into post-market studies. And those are the things that we're talking about, right? Of not just having this pre-market study get to market and then be done with it and wash our hands of it. It's not going to work. It doesn't fly anymore. And so continuing to evaluate your medical device post-market is obviously extremely important for the reasons that you touched on also. Those are the things that we're kind of grappling with.
Well, and I think, you know, it amazed me, and it didn't occur to me at first, but I was touring one of our pharmaceutical manufacturers. Mm-hmm. And they were talking about the fact, I said, you know, if you're going from one size batch to another size batch, and she said, oh, we have to recall everything. I said, you mean with the FDA? She says, oh, no, with the FDA, with the Europeans, with the Japanese. She started rattling off all these people. And I said, well, no wonder we can't change anything. No wonder it's so hard to innovate in the manufacturing process if you have to go back and get it requalled by everybody every time.
Yes, that's real.
So that probably has a pretty major impact on why, when we're, as an industry, getting a lot of pressure to reduce costs, at the same time, that regulatory burden with all these countries, not just our own.
Yeah, it hurts innovation at times, it does, right? Because the post-marketing requirements for reporting in the US, in addition to, like you mentioned, in the Chinas and the Japans of the world, it's forcing us to make decisions based on those reporting requirements that might not be driving the best innovation moving forward. It's a real concern of having to break different things out and do things differently because I'm concerned about a 2-year re-registration in Japan or China.
And then maintaining the certifications that you have to maintain, be it ISO 1345:2016 as you enter these other markets. Canada is moving to a program called the Medical Device Single Audit Program, which is going to be different in addition to the ISO 1345. So especially as you start expanding your market internationally, just the cost of maintaining those certifications gets to be a significant expense. And for a startup, your market really has to be significant, and it has to be immediate just to pay for the recurring audit fees, the recurring cost of administrating your quality system to stay compliant so that you pass the audit. All of these things are things that I see smaller companies underestimating what the ongoing cost and sustainability of just the regulatory maintenance is going to be.
You see that too?
Yes, yeah.
So, you know, as we look forward, mm-hmm. There are going to be a lot of discussions on the regulatory pathways. We have the new breakaway pathways that were designed in 21st century cures mm-hmm. for medical devices, which drugs have had for a long time. Mm-hmm. And so we were all like, yeah, let's get that done. If FDA doesn't have the funding or we don't have the support from Congress, are they actually going to help at all? I mean, isn't that what that $500 million that was supposed to go to them was for?
Yeah, that's all kind of to be determined, right, over the next year of how the new commissioner comes in and utilizes that funding. I mean, I think we're optimistic, right, that he comes from a drug background, so he has industry experience, but I think that's going to be the determiner. I mean, we have to wait and see of how he comes in and what his concerns are and how he implements change within the agency. But yeah, it's a real concern. I mean, reviewers are concerned about public health, and if they get their funding cut and if they're not able to hire new people, then how does that translate to the impact to the industry? I think, right, if I'm a review, I'm going to put the clock on hold as much as possible, right, and slow things down so I can keep up with my workload. But it's we'll see. Yeah.
Go ahead.
I'm sorry. I would like to bring up one point that Dr. Barker made during her speech at lunch, and that when she started talking about the funding that was allocated to the NIH and the FDA under the 21st Century Cures, she called the $500 million to the FDA really a penance of what the FDA needs. And the reason that is because that $500 million to the FDA is just enough to implement the programs that 21st Century Cures requires. It's not enough to do the maintenance, the updating, the replacing antiquated systems that the FDA is currently using that are broken down and slowing down their processes. It's just enough money to add more to them. So to me, I felt like that she really hit the nail on the head when you hear that the FDA it got $500 million underneath 21st Century Cures, that's really totally inadequate to keep the ball efficiently rolling in FDA. So penance was definitely the right term for that.
Okay. Closing thoughts, Joni? Anything we didn't cover that, if you were starting now, okay, you didn't have all the experience you have now, what do you wish somebody had told you?
Oh, boy. I think the regulatory environment is ever-changing, right? Just when you think that you have an understanding of what's going on, things change. And so get used to the change. And I think that's what success looks like.
Michelle?
I absolutely agree. And we've talked a lot about some really big and high-level changes within the Institute of Health and the FDA. But those are what's going on at a very large political level. Their FDA is still turning out guidance documents, recognizing consensus standards. Just this year alone, FDA plans on publishing or finalizing 30 new draft guidance documents. So you really can't underestimate the rate of change and the level of application to your technology. And if you don't understand all those factors, then your submission could easily get derailed or sidetracked because you weren't aware of the political environment surrounding your technology or FDA's current state-of-the-art thinking.
Great. Yeah. Great.
You would have had to schedule time way in advance to get this much great advice from these two very talented regulatory experts. What do you say we give them a big round of applause?